Hi, everyone. I'm Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse, founder and president of the Ruth Institute. And this is one in a continuing series of core truths and beliefs of the Ruth Institute. Today, I want to talk to you about censorship and propaganda. The fact is that big tech has been censoring people pretty much on the right for now quite a while. They just shut down the YouTube channel of our friends over at LifeSite News. Amazon has shut down books of people who are friends of ours, shut down books, in some cases shut down the whole channel. And as we know famously, Twitter shut down Donald Trump. Twitter is not afraid of the president of the United States. That's really something in a way, isn't it? But I don't want to go too much into that. What I want to talk to you about is the fact that to defend the family, we really have to confront the reality of censorship and propaganda. It is an intimate part of the sexual revolution. And that's what I want to get across to you today. For a lot of conservatives, the idea of the establishment going after you in the way that they're now doing so visibly, that's kind of a new thought for a lot of people. But for us in the pro-life, pro-marriage movement, that's not a new thought. That's been around for a long time. So let me spell this out for you, why it is that we're so much under the gun as far as censorship and propaganda is concerned at the pro-family movement. Let me review what the sexual revolution is. The Ruth Institute teaches that the sexual revolution has three components. The first is the contraceptive ideology, which is the idea that a good and decent society should do everything possible to separate sex and babies from each other. So you can have sex without babies, you can have babies without sex. That's the contraceptive ideology. The divorce ideology says that you should do everything possible, a good society should do everything possible to separate both sex and babies from marriage. And that brings us to single parenthood and divorce itself and third party reproduction, lots of different family forms that separate children from one of their parents. That's the divorce ideology, that is a good thing to separate sex and babies from marriage. The third part of the sexual revolution is the gender ideology, which says that a good and decent society should wipe out all differences between men and women. Any differences you see between men and women are socially constructed and probably unjust. And so therefore, we should wipe out all of those differences. That's the mark of a good society. Except now that we have transgenderism, we are allowed to have differences between men and women if the people explicitly choose to bear those differences. And so what we really have is a statement that the body itself is insignificant. It's either what you see is either culturally constructed or socially constructed, or personally and technologically constructed and reconstructed and deconstructed. The body is not particularly important. Now, here's what's significant about this whole package of three ideologies of the sexual revolution. Every one of those points is false, factually and demonstrably incorrect. So it is actually true that men and women are different. And trying to create a whole society around the idea that men and women are interchangeable somehow, that cannot work. It cannot be done. Children actually do need their parents. So the divorce ideology is simply not true. It can't be true. You cannot make a world where the kids will all be all right, no matter what the adults choose to do. And thirdly, sex actually does make babies. And attempting to create a whole society where sex and babies are completely separated cannot work. It cannot, it has to fail. Now, for a long time, pro-family, pro-marriage advocates would say, by golly, I just won the debate because I just proved that it can't work. This is crazy. How many times have you said that to yourself? This is so crazy. It's got to fall. I used to think that too. But it turns out that's not the case. The fact that it's crazy and impossible does not slow these people down one iota. Have you noticed that? You can say that all day long and it doesn't change a thing. They just keep marching right on. So what you finally have to figure out here is that this is a system, this is an ideological system that is doing something else other than what it says it's doing. What we're doing is proposing a utopian fantasy world. It's a dreamscape. It's an imaginary world, a fantasy ideology. And it looks wonderful. It's promising heaven on earth where people can have all the sex they want and nothing bad will ever happen. People can switch out their sex partners anytime they want and nothing bad will happen. See? So it's a utopian fantasy that is being proposed. And what they're doing is convincing people that this impossible dream is not only possible, but that it's a high moral necessity. It's a high goal. And that if you're not on board with that high moral objective, that there's something wrong with you, that you are defective and you need to be brought along the path to join in with this thing. But see, here's the thing. You can never make it be true. You can never make this fantasy ideology come true. In order to make it come true, it requires a lot of power and it requires a lot of propaganda. Now, the fact that it requires a lot of power, I'm not going to talk about that part of it too much today. That is the subject, actually, of the sexual state. The book, The Sexual State, and all of the documentation and work that we've done around the sexual state is really about the fact that it takes a lot of power to do the impossible of making it seem like men and women are interchangeable or that sex doesn't make babies. It takes a lot of power to create that dream world. That's not what I'm going to focus on. Today, I want to focus on the fact that it also takes propaganda to keep this whole dream alive. See, because there are multiple types of propaganda that have to be put into place. First, you have to keep people believing in the dream. You have to keep people thinking that it really would be a wonderful thing if children didn't actually need their parents, if you could switch the parents out anytime you wanted to and nothing bad would happen to the children. If the children are so resilient, that would be a wonderful thing. So you have to plant that idea. You have to keep that going. And then when things don't go along according to plan, when somebody kind of goes, This isn't working. I don't like that. You know, this hookup thing isn't actually working. What you have to do is make it seem like there's something wrong with them. You can't let those dissenters speak out, you see. You can't let the children of divorce say, you know, I had five parents and it stunk, in the immortal words of one of my colleagues who was a child of divorce and whose parents divorced and remarried multiple times. It stunk. You can't let them have a voice, because as soon as they start saying, you know, this actually didn't work, the whole thing starts to collapse. And all of the brilliant power structures and brilliant dreams that have been built around the fantasy, all of that goes to pieces. So you've got your children of divorce who have to be suppressed, who have to be kept quiet. You know, when the kids aren't okay, what do we do about it when the kids aren't okay? Well, we take them for therapy. We put them on medication. We tell them that'll be fine if you just get with the program. Why is Johnny so angry about this, right? We put him on drugs. The post-abortive woman. Now, here's an interesting case. The post-abortive woman in the abortion ideology, she doesn't exist. She doesn't exist. No woman has ever regretted her abortion. And oh, by the way, if you find a woman who's depressed after her abortion, that's because she was depressed in the first place. And, you know, contraception never fails. That's not worth thinking about. If you use it correctly every time, it won't fail. If your contraception failed, it's your fault. You're going to tell this to a bunch of teenagers, right? Use it correctly every single time. Is that a fantasy or what? So you look at these different groups of people who have been impacted by the sexual revolution, who have been harmed by the sexual revolution. You look at your refugees from the gay lifestyle. There are a lot of people who have walked away from participation in a gay lifestyle or a lesbian lifestyle. There are people walking away from transitioning from one sex to the other who are trying to come back, right? There are a lot of people walking away from the ideology. And they never get a platform. Do you notice that? They never get a platform. In fact, what happens to them is they get scolded, they get marginalized, they get deplatformed, right? These are the people who get into a lot of trouble because they are threatening the ideology at its core. The so-called ex-gays get maligned as much as anybody in society. That's a very fast way to get yourself taken down from YouTube, right? Is to say something against any parts of these ideologies, particularly your personal testimony. It's amazing how often that happens. So this is what we're dealing with. We're dealing with a system which is itself irrational. And in order to prop up the irrationality, all of the contrary evidence has to be suppressed. Right? So that's, what does it mean to suppress evidence? That's censorship. That's exactly what it is. So that's why we can continue to see this. Another type of propaganda that you see is omission and distortion. So, for instance, I can remember a few years ago, a big study came out showing that there were certain harms associated with the use of hormonal contraception, increased risks of strokes and heart attacks. You know, those risks have been known for a long time, but it was another very big study, I think over a million observations, you know, so you couldn't blow it off as being a, you know, poorly done study or something, you know, big study showing these elevated health risks. And the headline said, increased risk from contraception, but not by much. You know, it was like, what are these people even thinking? You know, they'll put it in, and they'll have an expert saying, but we think that risks are worth the, you know, that the risks are tolerable, the risks are acceptable. And you're thinking, acceptable to whom? Why don't you just give us the facts and let us decide for ourselves? But you see, they can't bring themselves to do that. It's like they can't stop themselves from editorializing, even about a big scientific study like this. Back to the post-abortive woman. Another issue that we've seen, and that our colleague, Father Paul Sullins, has done some research on this, that even the kinds of questions that are asked about women's post-abortive experience reflect the bias that people have that this is a harmless procedure, that nothing bad ever really goes wrong. It'll be fine. She'll get over it. This kind of stuff. So the question they never ask, did you want the baby? And is there a difference in how people feel about aborting a child that actually they wanted? Maybe it was mistimed, maybe it was unplanned, but in fact, once they were pregnant, they wanted this baby. And how does it feel to her to abort that baby? Father Sullen shows that about 20% of women will tell you flat out, I wanted this baby. And their mental health outcomes are terrible as a result of that. But you never hear that kind of thing. So the kind of censorship, suppression, distortion, omissions, that is par for the course for a fantasy ideology. A fantasy ideology needs all of that untruth and half-truth in order to stay afloat. Because after all, what the fantasy ideology is promising you is heaven on earth. We know as Christians, God doesn't promise us heaven on earth. God promises us heaven in heaven. So we're not looking for heaven on earth. We're not surprised when things aren't perfect. But if you can sell people on the idea that it's possible, if we just do everything right, we could have this. We could have heaven on earth. And all those people who don't want us to have it, oh, it's their fault, you see. Which brings us to the next point. The ideology, the fantasy ideology, is always a tool for the accumulation of power. It is a soft power means of accumulating hard power. It's designed to disarm and silence people so that they will not object to what is going on. And there's a savior class, the people that if you just give them enough power, everything will be fine. Then there's all the propaganda that has to go along with it. And then there's always a scapegoat class. Why is there always a scapegoat class? And, you know, if you start thinking through about ideologies generally, you'll see that all ideologies have a scapegoat class, right? But the reason they have to have a scapegoat class is that no matter how much power they have, no matter how much propaganda they pump you with, mothers are still attached to their babies. And men and women are still different. They cannot create this heaven on earth. So when the heaven on earth doesn't materialize, they gotta have somebody to blame. So that is a part of the package that goes along with trying to create a fantasy ideology. The impossible goal, the propaganda, the accumulation of power for the savior class, and then the identification and blame attached to the scapegoat class. It's their fault. If only those stupid Christians would just shut up about the right to life, no woman would ever feel guilty about her abortion again. And all those women who do feel guilty, all those women who are heartbroken, all those women who wish they had that baby, we never get to see them. We never get to hear from them. And every one of them is isolated and alone, thinking, I'm the only one that has this problem. It's inhuman, really, when you see how the ideology actually operates. But this is why we should never be surprised when big tech censors us. We should never be surprised by media bias. Given that they have drunk the Kool-Aid, as they say, given that they've bought into the utopian ideology, given that they want the fantasy ideology and they want this dream to come true, they are going to suppress some people. They have to. And so therefore, we cannot just be winsome about the defense of the family. Sometime, sooner or later, we have got to put our foot down and say, they're speaking untruths. And I don't care what happens to me. I'm going to speak the truth. I'm Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse for the Ruth Institute. Thank you for watching.